Hello everyone. Our presentation today is titled Conflict Handling Styles or Conflict Management Styles. And here basically we want to find out what are the various methods, what are the various styles of handling or managing conflicts. You know, we've talked about the various types of conflict, interpersonal, interstate, you know, depending on what parties are involved in the conflict. All right, how can conflicts be effectively managed or handled? Now, in order for us to understand, properly manage conflict, it's important to understand the dynamics. We've talked about the dynamics of conflict, you know, the three-dimensional nature of conflict and all of the other issues relating to dimensions of conflict. What are the causes and all of those? Now, this information is necessary to properly manage conflict. And of course, to achieve the benefits of peace. All right. Now, many people think that conflict or peace is just the absence of war, the absence of anarchy or conflict, as it were. But peace is a lot more than that. You know, peace is a product of not just hard work, not just time, you know, but it's also a product of compromise, you know, a middle ground kind of arrangement between the parties that are involved. And for us to achieve sustainable peace, you know, it involves, like I said, sufficient time, you know, to understand the issues, to decide what is the best management, the best conflict management style or conflict handling style to adopt in resolving the issue. And even in implementing such or in exploring such conflict management styles, it also involves, depending on what style is involved, it involves time, it takes effort. It takes commitment, you know, resources in order to ensure that peace is sustainable, you know, and that all the parties involved reach a mutual agreement in resolving such conflict. Now, there are so many styles or methods of managing or handling conflict, which we'll talk about in the following slides. Five major styles of handling conflict, and these are styles that are proposed by Thomas and Kalman. Or Killman, rather. The first style is called the accommodation style. Now, this is a style that involves one party conceding, you know, to a very high level to the other party. All right, it involves a very high level of concession. So, two parties are involved in conflict. One party agrees or completely agrees, accommodates the position of the other party. All right, so we said accommodation requires that one party accepts completely the position of the other party in the conflict, you know, just to ensure that the issue or the conflict is resolved. One party completely accepts the position of the other party. Now, obviously, this style might be disadvantageous, you know, to the party that is accommodating, that is accepting, or that is conceding. It might be a disadvantage because the party that is accommodating might not be able to achieve its goals in the conflict, you know, might not be able to achieve its objective, might not be able to achieve the desired outcome that party expected from the conflict, you know, because it has to accept or accommodate completely the position of the other party. So in this sense, it might not be an advantage per se, you know, but sometimes this is the best way of managing conflict, especially, you know, when the other party is an expert in providing the solution to that conflict. You know, when you find out that in a conflict between you and someone else, you don't have so much expertise in resolving that conflict, and maybe the other person, you know, has the expertise, has a knowledge about what the issue that is causing the problem is. You know, in such a condition, in such a case, you want to accept the position of the other party, knowing that the other party is an authority, is an expert in that issue. And of course, their advice, their suggestion may be the best way out. You know, so in such a situation, you just want to accommodate and accept completely the position that the other party is proposing to resolve the conflict. Now, one of the disadvantages of this is that one of the advantages is that it may help to preserve the relationship between the two parties in the future. You know, so because one party has completely accepted or conceded to the position of the other party, the relationship will not be further strained. And in the future, it's possible to sustain that relationship between these two parties, even though they once were in conflict, but they can have mutual relationship, you know, cordial relationship going ahead because of the way the conflict was handled. You know, we've talked about its advantage, the fact that the objectives or expectations of one party is not met because it has to concede, you know, or accept completely the position of the other party. But in the long run, it helps to preserve relationship, you know, and of course, it might also help to effectively solve the problem, especially when the other party is an authority or an expert. The second method is avoiding or avoidance. That's the second style or method of handling conflict. And in this style, which is also regarded as the tortoise style, here you want to simply avoid, or you want to simply walk away, basically, from this issue, from the issue or from the conflict, you know. So no party, you know, achieves anything in this conflict because the two parties just basically just walk away, you know, from the issue and want to ignore, basically, you know, the conflict that is going on. All right. Now, this method is best used when the issue is very unimportant or very trivial, you know, and especially when you find out that there's no chance for you to win in such an argument or such a conflict. You know, you just simply want to avoid it. And even perhaps more so when it is costly, you know, when undertaking the conflict might be a more costly exercise. You want to avoid such a conflict because maybe you don't have the costs, you don't have the funds, you know, to invest in resolving such a conflict. All right. And of course, the atmosphere too, within which the conflict occurs, might be a reason for you to avoid it. There are certain times when the time of the conflict or the place of the conflict is not conducive. And because you don't want to raise much more dust than is already raised, you just want to avoid the conflict and simply just walk away. All right. Now, there's this notion that time heals wounds. You know, there's sometimes too, you just think that, oh, the conflict will just resolve itself. Time will just take care of the issue, and you don't need to respond. So you just avoid it, hoping that time, you know, would mend or would address the issue at hand. You know, but sometimes too, we know that time doesn't heal every wound. So that is one disadvantage of this conflict, because it might reoccur. You know, if you just hope that time would take care of it, and time doesn't, it means that the conflict might reoccur. You know, so this is one reason why it's not very good to avoid conflict. But sometimes, you know, avoiding conflict the method of avoidance or avoiding is one of the best ways to handle or manage a conflict. You know, depending on the circumstances, depending on the type of conflict it is, depending on the dynamics of conflict. And that's why we are saying that in order to decide on what style of management, of conflict management, is best appropriate, it's important to first of all understand the dynamics of the conflict in question, you know, because that will inform the style, you know, or the management method or approach to be used in handling the conflict. All right. Now, we're saying that this method of avoidance will lead to a lose-lose situation, you know, where none of the parties basically benefits anything from the, or gains or wins, you know, from the conflict, because the conflict is simply avoided. All right. So that is the avoidance method or avoidance style of managing conflict. It's one where parties just walk away from the conflict, hoping that time will heal it. Or because the time is not conducive, the place for the conflict is not conducive, you know, it will cost, it's expensive to resolve the conflict, all right? And so, or perhaps the issues are not so important. They just simply avoid or ignore the issue completely. You know, so the third method is collaboration. And here, it is more of a win-win situation, you know. The parties involved are coming together, are partnering, all right, to provide a solution to to the issue at hand. So at the end of the conflict, the both parties win to some extent. The both parties, you know, win in the conflict. So everybody goes satisfied at the end of the conflict. So when the conflict is resolved, everybody's, all the parties involved are satisfied. That's what collaboration entails, you know. And of course, this is the best method of this appears to be the best method of managing or handling conflict, you know. But it doesn't come cheap too, all right? It involves a very high level of cooperation among all the parties involved. All the parties must be committed, not just cooperating, but committed to resolving the conflict, all right? And such commitment will involve a lot of time, a lot of resources, you know. And in fact, in some cases, you might even need to redefine the conflict so that there's a wider environment, you know, there's a wider room for all the parties to benefit from such a conflict. So basically, this means that, you know, and especially when the conflict scenario is complex, you know, when the conflict is a complex kind of conflict, there might be need to redefine the issues involved in the conflict, you know, so that all the parties involved can benefit equally from such a conflict. And that's why, again, we're saying that conflict management styles or conflict handling styles, you know, must be a product of a proper understanding of the dynamics of the conflict. So whatever style that individuals or groups decide to adopt in managing or handling the conflict must be a result of the fact that such individuals or groups have properly understood the nature of the conflict, the causes of the conflict, and the dynamics of the conflict, because that will inform, you know, the most appropriate style to use in resolving such a conflict. All right. Now, one of the downsides is that, of course, it requires a high level of trust, you know, that every party will be fair, every party will look out, you know, for the interests, will be committed to resolving the conflict in such a way that all the parties, you know, win at the end of the day. So it involves a high level of trust, you know, it takes longer time, it takes effort, it takes energy, you know, emotional, physical, mental energy to invest in resolving such a conflict. So at the end of the day, all the parties go home satisfied, you know, and that's why it says that this is the best method of managing conflict. Compromise is the fourth method. Compromise is number four. Of course, this is in no particular order, but compromise is number four in this presentation. All right. Now here, it requires cooperation as well, you know, but not the kind of cooperation that is required for collaboration. All right. But it requires a fairly moderate level of cooperation, and of course assertiveness too. All right. Here, it's appropriate for scenarios where you need a temporary solution. So when it appears that in the conflict you don't have so much time, you don't have all the resources, and you just need the issue resolved, you know. And of course, you don't want to be at the losing end, you know, just like an accommodation where you have to accept completely what the other party is proposing. You know, you don't want to completely lose, but at the same time, you don't have all the time to invest in completely winning. So you just reach a middle ground, a temporary solution. All right, and of course, it is good where time is not on your side, and of course, you don't have resources to invest in resolving the conflict as well. So compromise doesn't produce a very long lasting peace, you know, because it is possible that at the end of the day, the issues come up again because they were not properly resolved in the first place, all right? So those issues can reoccur because of the lack of complete proper resolution of the conflict, because there was just a compromise, there was just a temporary solution, you know. And so this temporary solution can lead to frustration on the part of either party, you know, feeling that they could actually gain more from the conflict. And at the end of the day, down the line, that same conflict can reoccur between these parties. And of course, it's also possible you know, that instead of just investing a little more time, a little more resource in actually reaching a collaboration where there's a win-win situation among the parties involved, you know, compromise might appear to be a better option than collaboration. But in the long run, compromise does not lead to a complete win-win situation among the parties involved, you know, but rather a makeshift kind of solution, you know. And so where compromise occurs, you know, a better solution would have been collaboration, all right? But parties might be tempted to just end a conflict at a compromise rather than spending a little more time and effort to actually achieve a collaboration, you know, where there's a win-win situation. Now, one may wonder, what is the difference between compromise and accommodation, right? Since in the two, there's really no win-win situation. In collaboration, remember we said that one party completely accepts the position of the other party. So it means that one party is completely losing while the other party is completely winning, you know, because the position of the other party is completely accepted. One party concedes completely to the other party and accepts the position of the other party. Whereas in compromise, you know, the position of the other party is not completely accepted. But of course, at the same time, this other party is not completely winning either. You know, so there's a kind of middle ground. There's a kind of middle ground in compromise. All right, so that's the slight difference between accommodation rather, and compromise. You know, so whereas in accommodation, party A completely accepts the position of party B. All right, but in compromise, party A does not completely accept the position of party B, but of course does not also completely reject. So there's a kind of middle ground arrangement, you know, which is not completely a win for either party, but is also not completely a lose. All right, so it is somewhere in the middle. Okay, and we're saying that one of the disadvantages of this is that a little more time, a little more effort would have perhaps led to a more win-win situation where every party leaves satisfied. Now, the last approach is what we call the confrontation or competing style or approach for handling conflict. And here, it is more of a win-lose approach, you know, where every party comes very assertive to the conflict, you know. So each party is trying to maximize the conflict in such a way that it turns out in their favor, regardless of the interests, the expectations of the other party. All right. So here parties are self-interested, self-motivated, and all that they are after is to ensure that they win the argument, they win the conflict, you know, they come out of the conflict victorious. You know, whether the other party loses or doesn't lose is really not the interest of the parties involved in this kind of conflict. So it is more of a zero-sum kind of approach to conflict resolution, you know, where parties are coming to confront one another. And of course, the objective is to completely win in such an argument or in such a conflict situation, you know, perhaps at the expense of the other party. Now, again, the difference between confrontation and accommodation is that even though the two appear to be a win-lose strategy, you know, in one, the interests and the expectations of the other party is really not important. Whereas in the other one, in accommodation, party A is accepting party B's position based on reasons that we have stated before. Perhaps you want to sustain relationship. The other party is an expert in the situation, and so you feel that they have a better understanding of how to resolve the issue, you know. And so you accept, you accommodate the position of the party B. Whereas in confrontation, party A is really not interested in the opinion, in the position of party B. Party A simply just wants to win the argument at the expense perhaps of party B. You know, and so every party comes to the conflict with a competitive, assertive, confrontational, you know, approach, trying to win completely in such a conflict. And of course, this kind of conflict or this kind of style, this style conflict management also occurs in terms of emergencies. You know, when there's an emergency, there isn't sufficient time to actually sit down and find an amicable solution to the conflict, you know. And then of course, there's this confrontational approach. All right, so these are five distinctive styles or approaches, methods of handling conflict or managing conflict. All right, and like we have said, it's important that the parties involved in a conflict understand the dynamics of conflict, understand the causes of the conflict, understand the nature of the conflict before they go ahead to decide what style will best fit, you know, in resolving such a conflict. Because if you don't understand the dynamics, then of course it's possible that you might adopt a wrong style, and at the end of the day, you find out that the conflict is reoccurring, or that the parties are not satisfied in the resolution, or that for some reason, you know, the conflict is not really resolved. You see, so it's important to understand the conflict in order to better appreciate and adopt the best fit and style for managing or resolving such a conflict. All right. Now, other styles that are there, which of course you might want to add to the list, are role playing. All right. Here in role playing, the parties involved in conflict are existing within a set of rules. All right. So there are a set of rules that guide the interaction of these parties involved in the conflict. And in resolving the conflict, each of the party is interested in upholding the rule. You know, is interested in playing a role of a judge, basically, just to uphold the rule and ensure that they resolve the conflict based on the rules that exist. Now, of course, this also means that in some cases, the rule may each party may be on the losing side of the rule. So the rule may speak against or may go against the interest of one party, all right, or the interest of the upholding party, the role-playing party. So one party or the two parties perhaps are trying to play a role of upholding the law, upholding the rules. Now, if the interests of the parties are not guaranteed, or if the rules do not guarantee the interest of the parties, then of course it means that the parties will lose. But still, the parties want to uphold the rule, whether the rule supports their interest or their expectations from the conflict or not, you know. And so in this case, the rule basically that guides the relationship or interaction of the parties is what resolves the conflict. So if parties are able to uphold and maintain the rule, then perhaps the conflict would be resolved, you know, to a very large extent. You know, whether it supports the expectations of the parties or not, all right, but as far as the parties are committed to obedience to the rule, and then they are able to uphold the rule in the conflict, it means that the conflict will be resolved. The next one is band aid, all right, band aid. This style, more or less, is like a first aid approach to resolving conflict. All right, you have a third party that tries to temporarily just resolve the conflict. Let me give you an example. If you have two people who are fighting, you know, you see two boys or two men or two women, two ladies fighting in the street, and then a third party just comes and separates the quarrel and separates the fight, you know, just puts them apart and say, oh, you guys stop fighting, you know. The person has provided a band aid, not necessarily going further to ask why are you fighting, you know, what caused the quarrel, what are the issues involved in the conflict. The person simply just separates the fight and then walks away. The person has provided a band aid, a temporary solution to the conflict, you know, by separating the parties. But of course, the conflict continues, you know, the conflict continues at the background. So the conflict has not really been resolved, but of course it has just been temporarily suspended, perhaps. All right, that is what a band aid style implies. A third party intervention, of course, involves, like we have mentioned in previous lessons, the involvement of a third party that is trusted, you know, a mediator that is trusted to help resolve the conflict. And of course, this mediator must speak with the both sides, must be trusted by the both sides, and must intend to help the both sides resolve the conflict to a very, very amicable extent. Joint problem solving. All right, here, the both parties are conscious of the fact that this problem needs to be solved or this conflict needs to be resolved. And so there's a kind of joint commitment to resolving the conflict, you know, to resolving it amicably as well. And of course, to salvage as much of the relationship that is left, you know, among the parties involved. So there's a joint effort in joint problem solving. It sounds like collaboration, but of course it's not necessarily collaboration, because in collaboration there are certain details that are emphasized. There's a win-win, there's investment of time, investment of resources, you know, but in joint problem solving, all of these details and specifics, you know, might not necessarily be emphasized. All right, so joint problem solving basically just entails that parties are conscious of the need to resolve a problem, you know, parties are committed to resolve that problem. And of course, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter how the conflict turns out eventually. You know, the parties might not, it might not necessarily turn out in a win-win situation like it will in collaboration. You know, but of course, it will be said that both parties understood the need to resolve and came together to try and resolve the issue. All right. So these are other styles of conflict management. We have talked about accommodation, where a party A completely accepts the position of party B. We've talked about compromise, you know, where party A does not really accept, you know, wholeheartedly the position of party B, but of course comes to a middle ground with party B. We've talked about avoidance. All right, where the both parties basically just want to ignore or avoid the issue for lack of time, for inappropriate place, you know, or for the wrong timing, for the cost of resolving, for several other reasons. They just want to walk away, you know, from the situation, which we also said is called the tortoise style. We've talked about collaboration, you know, which we said is one of the best styles of handling conflict, you know, where there's a win-win situation eventually at the end of the conflict. Each party invests time, each party invests resources, you know, each party is committed to resolving the issue. All right, we've talked about confrontation or competing, where both parties come, you know, assertively to the conflict, and of course, they're not necessarily interested in what the outcome is for the other party, but they are just interested in winning the competition or the conflict for their own interest. All right, role playing, band aid, third party intervention, joint problem solving, all of these are other styles of handling conflict. Now, this diagram basically just tries to illustrate what we have been saying so far. And from the diagram, you can see that individuals approach conflict from either an assertive, or individuals have an assertive approach to conflict or a cooperative approach to conflict. And that's why you see assertive on the vertical column and then cooperative on the horizontal column. All right, so it is possible that individuals are either approaching a conflict assertively, you know, or approaching a conflict cooperatively. Now, when individuals have a low assertive approach to conflict, then it means that they will either be avoiding the conflict in the style of management, they will either try to avoid the conflict or they'll be accommodating. They want to accommodate the position of the other party. That means that is when they have, when they approach conflict with a very low assertive nature. All right, they will either want to avoid the conflict or be accommodating. And when they have a high assertive approach to conflict, they are competitive, you know, or they want to collaborate and achieve a win-win situation. So the style of handling also depends on the extent or the approach that the parties come to the conflict with. If parties come assertively to the conflict, then of course they might adopt a different approach or style in handling the conflict than when they come cooperative to the conflict. So we are saying that when parties have a high assertive approach to conflict, they are going to mostly adopt a competitive style or a collaborative style, depending on what kind of conflict is involved. And when they have a low assertive approach to conflict, they will either adopt an avoidance style or an accommodating style. Now, on the other hand, when parties approach a conflict with a high cooperative approach or a high cooperative attitude, they want to either be accommodating or collaborating. When their level of cooperation is high, they want to accommodate, sustain the relationship, accept the position of the other party. Or they want to cooperate and reach a win-win situation, invest time, be committed, invest resources, and achieve a situation where both parties win. When cooperation is low, or when they approach with a low cooperative attitude, they want to avoid the conflict because they are not so cooperative. They want to avoid the conflict, or they want to compete, to either win, and they don't care what the other party, whether the other party loses or not. They just want to win the competition or the conflict when they are not so cooperative, when they have a low cooperative attitude. So it depends on what kind of approach or what kind of attitude the parties approach the conflict with, determines also what style of management they will adopt. So when they are assertive, the style of management might be different from when they are cooperative, but at the middle is compromise. Whether you are cooperative or assertive, there's a possibility for compromise, depending on the kind of conflict as well. That's why we're saying that understanding the nature and dynamics of the conflict is very, very important in handling the conflict, or managing the conflict. Now, this is a table that shows, or some of the, we have discussed this as we looked at each of the styles, but for emphasis sake, it's important to remind ourselves again, when each of the styles can be used and what is the disadvantage of using each of the styles. For accommodation, we said that accommodation can be used, to build when accommodation as a handling style can be used when you want to build relationship between the parties. So when you want relationship to continue, the party A might just decide to accommodate and accept the position of party B. All right, when the issue is really not important to party A, but important to the other party, you just want to accept and concede to the other party because you find out that the issue on ground is more important to them, to the other party, than it is to you. So you want to just accept the position of the other party. All right, and when, of course, the other party has more experience, like we said, and so you feel that they may have a better understanding, a better solution to the issue, and so you just want to accept. So these are conditions when accommodation can be used. All right, what are the disadvantages of accommodation? Your own needs are not met, and at the end of the day, you might feel taken advantage of, and that is not very good in a conflict situation as well, because it can also lead to a repeat of the conflict. Now, when do you use avoidance, or when do you avoid conflict? When the issue or relationship is unimportant, you just want to avoid it, ignore it. To try and prevent an immediate conflict, or the time is not appropriate and place is not appropriate. We mentioned that if the time is inappropriate, if the place is inappropriate, you might want to avoid a conflict so that it doesn't escalate, or get out of hand at the wrong time, at the wrong place, or there are no resources enough to manage conflicts in the time and place that they occur. When someone else can resolve the conflict more effectively, you want to avoid it. Or when you feel you're not sure you win, So what are the disadvantages? Conflict may fester, they may linger for a long time because they have been avoided and ignored. So the conflict will not really be resolved, And of course, when you say that time will heal wounds, time might not necessarily heal all wounds as well, And so the relationship will remain just superficial, make-believe kind of relationship between the parties involved. Now, when do you use collaboration? When there's commitment, when there's agreement, you know, to implement a solution, or when sentiments have been disrupting the personal relationships. And of course, this is more peculiar in a work environment. You know, when you find out that the working relationship or interpersonal relationship has been strained for a long time by sentiment, you know, you might want to commit to ensuring that such an issue, a conflict, is resolved and there's a win-win situation, so that going forward, relationship can be better, can be more cordial. All right. Now, the disadvantage is that it wastes time, it takes time, it takes energy, it takes resources. All right. And of course, the process, the length of time that it takes might also get to frustrate the parties involved. You know, if, of course, they are not so committed to resolving the conflict, parties might get frustrated because it's taking long, and, you know, several back and forth in trying to resolve the conflict might frustrate the parties. All right. Now, compromise. When do you compromise? When an agreement needs to be reached and there's no enough time. You know, you need to reach an agreement, there's insufficient time, but you also don't want to concede and accept entirely the position of the other party, so you just reach a compromise. You know, when individual goals prevent collaboration, all right? To achieve temporary settlement in complex issues, you know, and so on and so forth. So, of course, on the other hand, it's also not very good because nobody really achieves their goals at the end of the day. You know, your goals are not completely met. They're just met halfway, you know, and eventually the conflict might reoccur because they were not properly resolved. You know, in competition or confrontation, when you need quick decisions to be taken, when you need decisive actions to be taken, or in case of emergency, you know, parties might adopt a competitive or a confrontational approach. You know, when values seem to be under attack, all right, when you feel that your value is being attacked, then of course the handling style might be confrontational or might be competitive. All right, when you feel important that you have to win that argument, then of course you might adopt a more competitive or confrontational handling style. And of course, one of the major disadvantages is that it weakens relationships because one party is only interested in its own objectives or outcomes in the conflict without looking at the interest of the other party. So these are some of the shortfalls or advantages of each of the handling styles that we have mentioned, the five major handling styles: accommodation, avoidance, you know, compromise, competition or confrontation, and collaboration. All right, so when we talk about handling styles of conflict, these are the five major handling styles that should come to mind. Of course, band-aid, role-playing, and all of those other ones are other styles that you might want to add, you know, but the five major styles are these ones that we have mentioned. Now, in conclusion, we have said that conflicts, you know, can be managed properly before they escalate to become full-blown violence, all right? And in order to decide on what is the best possible kind of handling style to be used in resolving conflicts, it's important to understand the kind of conflict as well, the dynamics of the conflict, the nature of the conflict, the causes of the conflict. You know, all of that would help decide what style is best for handling a conflict. Of course, peace can also be time-consuming. You know, it can be a painstaking effort which parties must invest in order to achieve. All right? Now, it's better to manage conflict rather than suppress or avoid them. Now, if relationships must survive, if peace must be sustained, then of course conflict should not be avoided. All right, but conflicts should be handled in such a way that peace is sustainable. You know, and of course that also takes us back to understanding the nature of conflict, because in some conflicts, avoidance is not the best way of handling such conflicts. All right. So in managing conflicts, it's important to ask what, it's important to ask why, and this is very, very important, and not who, in order to get to the root of the problem. You know, there are certain times when in handling conflicts, we are so interested in who did what, you know, who offended who, how did this person offend this person, you know. And so we're so important in the persons, we're so interested in the persons involved in the conflict. And when the interest in conflict resolution, you know, borders on persons, it is difficult to resolve or handle such conflicts. So conflict handling should deal more on what are the issues involved, you know, why did these issues come up. These are questions that would help to better provide solution or management, effective management to the conflict, and of course avoid a repeat. So we must de-emphasize the persons involved in the conflict and emphasize the issues, discuss the issues, you know, in trying to handle conflicts. Conflicts that are poorly managed can be damaging, you know, they can be time and energy wasting, and so on and so forth. So you want to make sure that you understand the kind of conflict so that you can adopt the best possible conflict handling style. All right, this is where we're going to end the presentation for today. I hope that this has been helpful. If there are questions, if there are comments, certainly we can continue the conversation afterwards. But in the meantime, thank you so much for listening.